So Thursday night and Friday morning, Ilan and Sherri observed the first yahrzeit of their son, Shemaria Zichri Vishner Glazer. It's a reminder of so much happiness and hope that we had last year that we'd be able to welcome him into this community, and all of the sadness last year of mourning this loss. So today we invite Ilan and Sherri to offer our sermon, talk about this parsha in honor of Shemaria Zichri's memory, and also to talk about this music box that we're going to be dedicating this morning. And as they give their sermon and share about death and child loss, if there's anyone that needs to take a step out of the room for now or during the sermon, we just want to say that that's completely okay. And to kind of do what we need to do to be of support, and also it's okay to say, I need to take a moment out in the hall, and we'll make sure to call you back when we begin Musaf. Kavod.
Shabbat shalom. How is your faith? How often do any of you, any of us, ask ourselves this question? When have you been asked this question? Do we ever question what exactly we are to have faith in or about? After Rabbi Berg returned from sabbatical last year, he came to visit us, and this is one of the questions he asked us. How's your faith? At the time, I said it was fine. I was, and am, still davening, and honestly hadn't thought much about it. Except when well-meaning people would respond to our loss and grief with comments about God's plan, and why Shemaria Zichri isn't with us in this world. But even that didn't really get me to question my faith. More just dismiss those comments as unhelpful because we just don't know what God's plan is or why our son isn't here. And in the past year, following Rabbi Berg's question, I have been thinking about faith more and more, thinking about God and my relationship to and with God, thinking about religion and rituals and meaning. I took a class through Chabad's Jewish Learning Institute called My God. And I took Rabbi Berg's class on faith. And they both left me asking questions. How is my faith? What is faith? What does God want from us? And what do we want from God? And then I read this parsha, and the parshiot that have come in earlier weeks, about God's actions and motivations, and I've been left with more questions. In this week's parsha, following the journey of the Israelites, up until this time, they've been enslaved in Egypt for generations and have just been freed following a series of plagues and miracles to show them who God is. Chapter 14, verse 4, God says that he's doing all these things, that I may gain glory through Paro and all his host, and the Egyptians shall know that I am God. And when the Israelites get to the Reed Sea with the Egyptians in pursuit, they cry out to Moshe asking, why have they been freed just to die here? Moshe responds, have no fear. Stand by and witness the deliverance which Hashem will work for you today. Chapter 14, verse 13. And following which, God, through Moshe, split the sea. The Israelites go through, and the sea comes back and drowns the Egyptians. So the first thing we have is have no fear, and that's supposed to mean have faith in God. Chapter 14, verse 31, thus Hashem delivered Israel that day from the Egyptians. Israel saw the Egyptians dead on the shore of the sea, and when Israel saw the wondrous power which Hashem had wielded against the Egyptians, the people feared God. They had faith in God and in God's servant Moshe. So now fear means faith. And the Israelites keep going, and they're thirsty, and they come to Marah, which has water, but it's bitter, so they can't drink it, and they complain. And the people grumbled against Moshe, saying, what shall we drink? So Moshe cried out to God, and God showed him a piece of wood. He threw it into the water, and the water became sweet. There God made for them a fixed rule, that they were put to the test. And God said, if you will heed your God diligently, doing what is upright in God's sight, giving ear to God's commandments, and keeping all God's laws, then I will not bring upon you any of the diseases that I brought upon the Egyptians, for I, Hashem, am your healer. Chapter 15, 26. Okay, so another way to have faith in God, to believe in God, follow God's laws, which we have not yet received, and God won't do bad things like God did in Egypt. So what exactly are we supposed to do to heed God? What does it mean, and is this just a precursor to the commandments that we'll receive next week? Follow those commandments, and I'll take care of you. The story continues. The Israelites keep going. They complain that they're hungry and are fed quail and man. They are told to gather the man, one portion for each day, and then two portions on Fridays for Shabbat, and then not to gather on Shabbat. But they don't believe, they don't have faith. And first they try gathering too much in one day, and then they try gathering on Shabbat. And God becomes angry and asks Moshe. And God says to Moshe, how long will you all refuse to obey my commandments and my teachings? How long will it take for you to have faith in me? How many miracles do I need to show you to give you a reason to believe in me? So the Israelites, despite witnessing all those miracles up until this point and being told they'll be taken care of, and in fact being taken care of, they're still struggling with having faith. And fair enough, they're still learning. They're making mistakes, being rebuked, and getting back on track for a little bit. So what about us? Where does our faith come from when we don't have these outward miracles and God talking to us and showing up in big ways like this? Where does our faith go when we experience unimaginable loss? Where does our faith go when the first commandment in the Torah is to be fruitful and multiply, and then we're introduced to three out of our four matriarchs struggling with infertility? Where does our faith go when we are told, do what I say and I won't bring any of the plagues upon you like I did in Egypt, and then our firstborn dies? I don't have answers for these questions. I do still have faith in God, but I don't know what that means most of the time. I've seen miracles in my time that I believe are from God, and I count as a miracle just having the opportunity to be pregnant and bringing Shemariah Zichri into our lives for the short while that he was. I feel blessed to be his ima, his mom, and I believe that we got him for a reason and that he is still here somewhere, somehow, in my heart, in the songs we sing to him and for him, and in this music box that we'll talk about shortly, with all the kids playing the instruments. Shemariah Zichri is forever a blessing in our lives.
Can we sing after tragedy? Who will sing with us? After the Israelites are freed from slavery, they sing Shira Hayam, the song of the sea. I invite you to open your Chumashim to page 405. Page 405, let's look at chapter 14, verses 30 and 31, which says, thus God delivered Israel that day from the Egyptians. Israel saw the Egyptians dead on the shore of the sea, and when Israel saw the wondrous power which God had wielded against the Egyptians, the people feared God. They had faith in God and in God's servant Moshe. Turn the page to 406. Says, then Moshe and the Israelites sang this song to God. Remember that piece. Moshe and the Israelites sang this song to God. And now let's fast forward a little bit. Turn to page 412. At the end of Moshe and the Israelites singing, we see chapter 15, verses 20 and 21. Says, then Miriam the prophetess Aaron's sister took a timbrel in her hand, and all the women went out after her and danced with timbrels, and Miriam chanted for them, "Sing to God, for God has triumphed gloriously. Horse and driver God has hurled into the sea." Miriam, the prophetess, Aaron's sister, was so enamored, enraptured, that she wanted to sing and dance as well. According to the Midrash, the angels also wanted to sing even before the Israelites were free, and God rebuked them. It says, while the Egyptian army was pursuing the Israelites, the angels in heaven wanted to sing to God the Almighty, however, would not allow it. "The Bnei Israel, the children of Israel, at this moment are crossing the sea in mortal fear," God said. "How can I let you sing?" After the Israelites had arrived safely at the shore, the angels once again attempted to begin their song of praise. God still refused to grant permission. "How can I let you sing while my creatures are drowning? My mercy includes all beings. Only after my children sing will you be allowed to follow suit." Was human song more important than that of the angels? Does our song somehow give permission for the angels to sing as well? One thing that especially surprised me in the text, chapter 15, verse 20 on page 412, it says, "Miriam the prophet, sister of Aaron, took the drum in her hand and went out to dance and sing." Why on earth is Aaron mentioned here? He's not singing with her. Why exactly does the Torah mention him? Commentaries have a few thoughts. Ibn Ezra says that when she first started prophesying, she was just Aaron's sister, as Moshe hadn't been born yet. All right, fine. Bechor Shor says the Torah generally identifies women by their oldest brother, which in fact happens with Aaron's wife, Elisheva. Earlier on in chapter 6:17, it says, "Aaron took to wife Elisheva, daughter of Abinadab and sister of Nachshon." Why is Nachshon mentioned there? Because the Torah likes to remind us who the older brothers are. Okay. Rashi says, "In my opinion, since Moshe and Miriam were both mentioned in connection with the songs, the text wished to mention Aaron as well. Connecting his sister, the prophetess, with him does him honor, especially since he too was a prophet and holy to God. Even when Aaron is not involved, he's worth mentioning. The ones we love, even when they are not with us, are worthy of honor and remembrance." Last year on this Shabbat Shira, Sherri and I were in the hospital with Shemaria. We studied Torah with him, we sang to him, we held him, we cried with him. It was devastating to know that that was the only Shabbat we had with his body, and I'm grateful we had even that. One of my favorite teachings comes from Rabbi Abraham Joshua Heschel, who said there are only three ways to respond to suffering. The first is to cry. The second is to sit in silence, and the third is to turn sorrow into song. Shemaria Zichri brought a lot of music into our lives. We hope and pray that wherever his neshama is, he is surrounded by song, free of all pain, and feeling all the love Sherri and I and others send him each day. Our time with Shemaria was much too short, and we'll do our best, even when he's not physically with us, to continue mentioning his name and bringing honor to his memory today and every day of our lives. Shemaria made us into parents, and through the gifts of music and love he brought to us, he has helped us begin to turn our sorrow into song as well. We pray that the melodies and the love he brought our way will always be with us, that he will always feel our love with him, that all of us who mourn will find ways to turn our sorrows into song. I suspect that when we do, the angels will be singing along with us.
Shabbat Shalom. So we do want to mention this beautiful box that's in front of us with much, much gratitude to Emily for helping us put this vision into this gorgeous piece of art. So after we lost Shamaria, we really were thinking between ourselves and with Rav Tyler and Rabbi Berg and others of how we can honor his memory and do something with the shul so that he continues to be part of this community. And ultimately, with Rabbi Tyler's help, we came up with the idea of a music box to really incorporate more music into the programming with the kids, with Discovery Lab, and to bring more of his music into the world. So then we were going back and forth about what designs to use, and ultimately we wanted some different visions of creation, and we wanted something alive and vibrant, and I think we got that. So we've got a rainbow on top, which of course brings so much hope to the world when we see a rainbow, and we've got flowers and plants and vegetation and butterflies on the front and on both sides, fish, you know, the sea, waters, and light. And on the back, which nobody can see yet, but I invite everyone to take a look when they have an opportunity, is the night sky with a moon and stars. And I don't know what else to say when I see the box. It's just really beautiful. And of course, on the top, Shamaria's music box as a way to honor our son and that his name continues to be amongst us and as a blessing. We're gonna sing one of the melodies that Shamaria brought to us.
In your Siddur, it's on the bottom of page 337. It comes from Psalm 23. It says, Ach tov v'chesed yirdefuni kol yemei chayai v'shavti beveit Adonai l'orech yamim. Only goodness and steadfast love shall pursue me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in God's house forever. Ach tov v'chesed yirdefuni kol yemei chayai. Ach tov v'chesed. Ach tov v'chesed yirdefuni kol yemei chayai. V'shavti beveit Adonai. Beveit Adonai le'orech yamimai. V'shavti beveit Adonai. Beveit Adonai le'orech yamimai. Ach tov, ach tov v'chesed. Ach tov v'chesed yirdefuni kol yemei chayai. Ach tov, ach tov v'chesed. V'chesed yirdefuni kol yemei chayai. V'shavti beveit Adonai. Beveit Adonai le'orech yamimai. V'shavti beveit Adonai. Beveit Adonai le'orech yamimai. May all of us be blessed with goodness and steadfast love, the knowledge that we're in God's house.
I want to thank you, Ilan and Sherri, for teaching this morning in Shamaria's memory and the ways in which you bring his memory and his into our community in so many ways through the music that you've brought into the community that has not only helped you all go through this year, but so many others in our community and others who are grieving in different ways. It's just occurring to me, I got to watch Emily paint this box over the last 3 weeks. It was a very elaborate process because she would have to come in and paint one color and then let the box dry and then come in the next day and paint for a little bit the next color and then let it dry. So it ended up taking a very long time. And I think that beyond just the way that that's how you have to paint a box like this apparently, it says something about maybe this journey of grief. That each time we sing these songs and each time we teach in his memory, we'll add another layer of paint. And as you go through this journey, all of the layers, all of the memories from before will still be there. We'll continue to add more music, more blessing into the world. So I know that our our youth are already so grateful to have these instruments. It's made Jewish Discovery Lab, and Shabbat is awesome, a lot louder than it used to be. We love it. And we hope that in this way, and in all of the ways that you as educators and helpers and people in this community are there for others, that we can be there for you, and that we can all continue to bring Shemar Yizichri's memory into this community.